Now turn to the fourth case on this morning's docket. It's case number 108944, State of Kansas v. Eli A. Betancourt.
May it please the court, counsel. Your Honor, my name is Carl Mann. I represent the appellant, Eli Betancourt. Your Honor, may I reserve 4 minutes for rebuttal?
4 minutes is granted.
Your Honor, I'd like to present three issues today and rest on the brief on the other issues. And I'd like to take them a little bit out of order from what they appeared in the brief. I'll be addressing issue number one, the suppression of the statement. Issue number five, the ineffective assistance claim, and issue number four, if I have time, on the sufficiency of evidence on the premeditation. Your Honor, with regard to issue number one, the suppression of the statements, Judge, I would urge the court to look at not simply the evidence presented at the suppression hearing, but taken to consider the totality of the circumstances, including the evidence presented at trial, to reach the totality of the circumstances.
Was there a renewed motion to suppress during trial?
I do not. It's been a long time, Judge, but I don't believe that the motion was renewed at the jury trial.
And if not, then how do we look at something that the trial court didn't have before it when it made its ruling?
Well, my argument on that is that a suppression issue does not simply look at the Fifth Amendment application, but also on the due process aspects and the right to a fair trial aspect of this. So, yes, if we strictly look at the Fifth Amendment aspect and the suppression issues there, then you would be limited to giving great deference to the fact finder at that time. However, when we also consider that a statement that is not voluntary has due process implications and implicates the defendant's right to a fair trial, I believe the court would then have the ability to look at the totality of the circumstances, which is only achieved by hearing all of the evidence, including what was at the trial. Regardless of whether the evidence comes from the trial or the suppression hearing, if we look at what we have here, we have a 19-year-old boy, and while he is obviously above 18 and therefore an adult, he is still a child in many respects at 19. And he had been drinking massive amounts of alcohol. Yes, he says to the police officer during the investigation or during the interview that he had 3 or 4 beers at 3 a.m., but that doesn't preclude the many beers and tequila shots that he had had earlier in the evening before 3 a.m. So we have a 19-year-old boy who is very intoxicated, or at the very least suffering from a massive hangover, who is scared, who is picked up at 6 o'clock in the morning. He knows what just happened. He knows exactly what just transpired. And so he's obviously going to be scared out of his wits when he's arrested at 6 a.m., handcuffed in a small room, away from family and friends, and not knowing what's going to happen. And that's key. The psychological impact of not knowing what happens next is important to the defendant's state of mind. He is stuck there from time of his arrest was about 6:15 in the morning. Eventually at about 2:15 in the afternoon, a detective comes in to talk to him. He is suffering from sleep deprivation. He's been up all night, and yes, while it appears on the video that he puts his head down a couple of times, we cannot tell for certain, and there's no evidence whether he was actually asleep. And I would suggest that whether or not there was any actual rejuvenating ability to sleep under those circumstances, or whether or not he actually had any decent REM sleep, I would suggest under those circumstances, handcuffed, being very scared, very hungover, that there's not much rejuvenating sleep going on during that time. The delay in the investigation, in the discussion with Mr. Betancourt, is designed specifically to build this lack of understanding what's going to happen next. It's designed to build that fear of what's going on. And so when we look at not just the alcohol intoxication and potentially the cocaine intoxication, but when we look at the psychological impact on a 19-year-old child of the totality of the circumstances, we start looking at the psychological compulsion effect that we have here. And I would suggest that that is significant. He knows what's happened. He knows that he's in a lot of trouble. And so if we look not only at the voluntariness of the confession, but also at the intelligent and knowing aspect of it, the psychological coercion starts becoming very important. Can somebody under that situation with the alcohol intoxication, etc., make an intelligent, rational decision the same as we would while sitting in this room? I would suggest that the likelihood of that is very small. And that the defendant's ability to bring logic to bear and make knowing and intelligent decisions about whether to waive his rights is significantly impaired. And this kind of pairs well with the second issue of the Van Cleve situation, or the ineffective assistance of counsel. What we had here was an attorney who admittedly is an experienced and a well-versed lawyer who was in a trial that went over a week and went into the Monday when she was supposed to be starting the trial in this first-degree murder case. During the preceding trial, she admits to the defendant's mother, "I'm not prepared to try Eli's case at this point." She does get a continuance of 1 week because she only receives the jury verdict in her preceding case on the Monday, and so the case was continued a week. She has hearings on the Friday in the motion to suppress, and then starts the trial on the Monday.
A coloring fact is that the prior trial was the co-defendant, Alejandro, and so it was on the same facts, basically, as this case, as your client's case, just a different defendant.
No, Your Honor. My understanding is that the prior trial that Ms. Osborne had, trial counsel had, was not on the co-defendant, but it was trial counsel's previous case that went over a week and resulted in the necessity for the continuance.
But didn't trial counsel testify at the Van Cleve hearing that this week was sufficient for her to be up to speed on the case?
That was her testimony.
And didn't the trial court basically make that credibility finding? So how do we reweigh that?
You reweigh it by looking at not necessarily the credibility of that statement, but the fact is this is a first-degree murder case, and she also testified she had only met the defendant 7 or 8 times. We look at the fact of whether or not that the fact that she was in another trial and admitted just a week previously that she was not prepared to try the case, whether that creates some sort of a conflict of interest for her, even in testifying, because she has an interest to the interest of this defendant, to her own professional reputation, and to her other clients and her calendar. And so what we start looking at there is not only her readiness to try the case, but whether or not the second issue of the 1507 claim was whether she had done sufficient investigation in consulting with an expert on the effect of intoxication, whether it's cocaine and alcohol or simply alcohol, before going to trial, and I would suggest before even going to the suppression hearing. So when we look at this issue and we see that counsel did not consult with an expert. Her position on that was this was a strategic decision that alcohol can simply is within the common experience of the jurors, which may or may not be true. While many jurors may have an understanding of what it's like to be intoxicated or how people act when they're intoxicated. The specific neurological effect on decision-making and logic and how we reach decisions was not explored, and I would suggest that is not within the purview of the average juror. And so, now, if counsel had said testified that she had previously studied this issue, or she had previously consulted with experts on this case and had decided that this would not be helpful to a jury, that would be a different case. This is simply a factor of she made the decision as an attorney that this is within the purview of the jurors and can simply be explained. I would suggest to the court that Ms. Osborne did not have, had not even done the necessary investigation at that point to make that strategic decision, so that the strategic decision itself is not a silver bullet that precludes any ineffective assistance, because she hadn't done the necessary investigation prior to making that decision. Your Honor, as I say, I'm almost out of time, so I would briefly just try to discuss the issue on premeditation and whether or not there was sufficient evidence to convict on the first-degree premeditated murder. Judge, there was evidence of intent to shoot, at least on the behalf of the co-defendant. There was evidence of intent to go to the house, but there was no discussion of killing anyone, no discussion of shooting any specific person, and no evidence that there was any plan to shoot at a specific person or kill anyone.
There was evidence that they waited to start shooting until the doorknob turned.
There's evidence that the co-defendant waited until the doorknob turned, but whether there was no evidence as to whether Eli knew that had seen the doorknob turn, was even standing there when the doorknob turned. The evidence was that he appeared to be shooting backwards because of the placement of the bullets in the gutter and the fascia of the house.
Didn't he say his foot was holding the door open, the screen door open?
At some point, there was testimony about that. Now, whether or not his foot was still there when the doorknob started to turn, my understanding that that was not what was happening. By that stage, he'd already had the...
I thought the forensic evidence was that the shots went through that, did not go through the screen door, or...
Well,
I mean, that, how does that square with the forensic evidence?
That is true.
Better question.
Well, the issue of simply whether or not whether Eli was holding the door open initially, and then when he had the disagreement with the co-defendant and left the scene saying, I'm not up for this, whether the co-defendant still held the door open. I mean, there are simply, you know, I can't speculate on what the evidence would have been, but yes, the forensic evidence was that the shots went through the door. But there was also forensic evidence of 22 rounds, which was the gun that Mr. Betancourt had, hitting the guttering around the house, which would be inconsistent with him standing in front of the door at the time of the shooting. Does that answer your question, Your Honor?
Perhaps, yes.
Perhaps. Your Honors, I would ask that on the premeditation issue, you find that there's a lack of evidence of premeditation that Eli adopted or knew of the intent and the mindset of the co-defendant, and that he specifically did not have premeditation, and vacate that conviction. Your Honor, this issue does go to the other issues of suppression and whether or not a expert on alcohol intoxication should have been consulted as well, and I would ask you to consider those as well. Thank you, Your Honor.
We have any further questions of counsel? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Judge.
May it please the court, counsel, Assistant District Attorney Matt Maloney for the state. I'll also argue issues 1, 4, and 5 and submit the other two issues on the brief unless there are questions on those issues. With respect to issue 1, which
Can
is
I
the-
Can I ask a preliminary question? Does that mean you're not pursuing your jurisdiction argument?
With respect to the restitution,
yes.
And I assume that you did receive the 609 letter that I filed. Yes, it is our position that we think that the court does have jurisdiction over this appeal. in light of the recent development in the case law. Our position is that what happened in this case does sufficiently, that essentially sentencing did happen, that the restitution was ordered, and therefore the court does have jurisdiction. With respect to issue one, the suppression issue, of course, this court gives great deference to the trial court and does not reweigh the evidence. The first thing that I want to point out, and this is something that I have argued and seen in a handful of cases, and it's just a general premise, is that I recognize that obviously for years and years there have been interrogations that have been conducted, and many times there's not a video or any type of a recording of a suppression here, of a interview. And clearly this court is capable, as is the district court, of ruling on suppression motions just based on testimony. And when there is not a video or an audio recording, then that's perfectly appropriate. However, in a case such as this, in which there is a video, in which there is a transcript of the suppression hearing, and the defense is on appeal arguing that the district court erred, it's the state's position that when the defense fails to provide this court with the best possible evidence, which is the video of the suppression of the interview, that a defendant should never be able to prevail on appeal in that circumstance and show that the district court was wrong, but we're not even going to give you the most pertinent evidence in the case. It, to me, that would be similar, and nobody that knows me will be surprised to see me making a sports reference here, but it would be like if a replay system in sports, if a team challenged and says, we want you to replay this, but we're not going to ask you to actually look at the replay. We're just going to try and describe to you what happened. Even though there is a replay here, we don't want you to see it. That's essentially what's happening in this case. The defendant is the one that has the burden to show that prejudicial error occurred at the district court level, and yet denied this court the opportunity to have the video. Now, I obviously did add the video to the record, and so it is before you, and you're certainly capable of looking at it. And as I've argued in the brief, it very much supports the state's position and the trial court's ruling. But just as a general matter, it is the state's position that when there is a video that perfectly shows what happened, that when the defendant fails to produce that video for the appellate court, I think the defense should never be able to actually prevail and show that they've met their burden of demonstrating that the trial court erred in a reversible way. Now, as to the merits of the issue, as I noted in the brief, when you look at the video and when you review the transcript, what you'll see is that during the time that the defendant was in this room, he was repeatedly offered food and drink. He was given a bathroom break before the interview. The video shows that he did rest and probably nap during the time that he was there. He told the officer, the detective, that he had consumed 3 or 4 beers 12 hours before the interview. This was a 19-year-old adult. He had a GED. He appropriately answered and tracked with the detective's questions. He said that he had not been under the influence of any drugs. He was not cuffed during the actual interview itself, and he never asked to talk to anybody. Now, counsel has argued that there should also be consideration of the evidence that came in during trial. And I guess, as Your Honor pointed out, Justice Lugard, maybe that would be a valid argument if the defense had raised that issue at the time of trial, or if they had made that argument at the time of trial. But they never did that. And this court's job
There wasn't a contemporaneous objection to the introduction of the confession?
There was a contemporaneous objection, but there was no specific argument. The defense didn't ask the court to then also consider additional...
Well, I don't understand the rationale given for the need for contemporaneous objection is to allow the court to reconsider its ruling based on how facts have come in at trial. And so you're saying that judges that are told that, the defendant needs to remind the judge, now you need to take into account all the evidence that you've just heard?
I think that if you are trying to say that new additional evidence should specifically be considered, My point would be that this court's job is to review, is a reviewing court, to review for errors the decision that the district court made. And in this situation, at the time that the suppression issue was before the district court, the defendant had never once mentioned cocaine. And the extent of the evidence with respect to alcohol was that he had consumed three or four beers 12 hours prior. So for the defense to now say, well, you should also consider this evidence about cocaine and this evidence that he had consumed these ridiculous quantities of alcohol, that's not the decision that the trial court, or that's not the evidence that the trial court had before it.
Did it have that evidence when it ruled on the objection?
I don't think it was, not at that time. My recollection is it did not, because I think that what happened was that counsel simply lodged an objection at the time that Detective Mama was first asked to start testifying about the interview, and it was just a continuing objection. And the record will obviously correct me if I'm mistaken on that, but there certainly was never any specific argument made by the defense that in light of this new testimony about the alcohol and cocaine, you should reconsider things. But be that as it may, as I've argued in the brief, when you look at this video, this is very much a voluntary statement. The defense makes much of the fact that the defendant did not sleep the night before, which is essentially the morning of the interrogation. And to that, I would point out that in suppression issues, what this court looks at is to see if there's any misconduct on the part of police. It's not simply to see whether there are factors that might have made, in other words, just because there's a factor that might show that the defendant is tired, when there's no indication that the police are responsible for that, and certainly that's not what happened here. The defendant didn't sleep the night before because he chose to go out to a party and then kill somebody. The police didn't have anything to do with his lack of sleep.
The police don't have anything to do with age or maturity or mental deficiencies, but we take those things into consideration when we consider voluntariness, don't we?
That's true. I would argue that the distinction there is that those are largely factors. Something like age is a factor that is out of anybody's control. Whereas the defendant's ability to sleep was something that was a personal choice on his part. And to the extent that he didn't sleep the night before, I don't think that you can inoculate yourself from being interrogated by simply choosing not to go to bed the night before.
I'm confused. You seem to be arguing that, or you're not arguing that voluntary intoxication is not a factor. You argued why he was not intoxicated to the point where it made it involuntary. So what's the difference if you voluntarily consume drugs or alcohol, or if you voluntarily don't sleep? Why aren't those still factors on both of them on voluntariness?
Well, perhaps if you could show that the police exploited the lack of sleep, maybe that would be maybe that's the way that issue could be a factor to consider. But I don't think in this case there's even an argument that the police somehow intentionally exploited that. And again, I'd point out that the fact that the interview video shows that he was at the very least resting and in all likelihood napping during the time that he was in the interrogation room awaiting the interview. But regardless, the bottom line is that you look at the totality of the circumstances, and when you do review that video, I think that this shows that he clearly was, regardless of whether he was tired, he was tracking every question, he appropriately answered, he was having no difficulty following along here. I would go so far as to say that this was really a textbook interview. If this type of interview is deemed to be coercive or deemed to be suppressible, then I think that there's essentially no interrogation that could ever be allowed based on the facts of this case. So for all of those reasons, we would assert that issue one does not entitle the defendant to relief. With respect to issue five, the ineffective assistance of counsel claim, it seems that there are really two factors the defense is focusing on. One has to do with whether counsel was prepared for trial. And with respect to that, counsel did testify at the Van Cleve hearing that she had told the defendant's mother that a week or so before trial, she did not yet feel prepared. And so what did she do? She rectified that. She asked for a continuance, and it was granted. And counsel testified that that continuance gave her the time that she needed to get ready. That by the time that her the verdict in her other case that she was working on came in, and that there was enough of a gap between that date and the date the trial started in this case to allow her to prepare. This is a very experienced defense attorney. It's obviously no secret to this court that defense attorneys have more than one client at a time. So the mere fact that she had been representing another client in the weeks leading up to this case certainly is not a reason to find that she couldn't have been prepared for this trial, especially when she did tell the court that that continuance gave her the time that she needed. Furthermore, she testified at length about the amount of meetings that she had with the defendant. She specifically said that they discussed the theory of defense, that the defendant knew and was on board with all the strategic decisions that she made. She was ready for trial. She testified to that. The district court clearly found that to be credible, and this court should not disturb that type of a credibility finding. With respect to the whether she should have consulted an expert or presented an expert, again, there's two prongs to that. One is the cocaine issue. Well, that's a non-starter because the first time the defendant ever mentioned cocaine was in his post-trial motion. Counsel had absolutely no basis to think that cocaine was an issue when her client never said anything to her about cocaine. She had asked him to give her the relevant information, and he never mentioned cocaine. So counsel certainly can't be held to be ineffective for failing to pursue a defense that was not there for her to pursue. With respect to alcohol, I think she testified at length at the Van Cleve hearing about her strategic decision with respect to that. She noted that the review of the video showed that he was coherent and answering questions articulately in the immediate in the aftermath of the crime, and she explained why she decided to, rather than using an expert, simply try and argue alcohol to the jury. These were strategic decisions. This was not something that she did without putting thought into the matter or exploring her options. These were strategic decisions, and again, this was something, I think specifically the alcohol issue was something that she and her client discussed and agreed upon before trial. With respect to issue four, which is the sufficiency argument, clearly this court is aware that it must review in the light most favorable to the state and disregard evidence that conflicts with the verdict. Counsel mentioned the fact that there was no testimony or evidence that the defendant and his cohorts had specifically said to one another, "Let's go kill anybody." I would note that rare is the case in which the state has that type of evidence. Premeditation is often usually found proven by other type of evidence, circumstantial evidence. In this case, what you've got is evidence that the defendant and these other men were at this party. There is a discussion about the incident that had happened with the defendant's brother a couple of weeks prior. People were talking about how they should go get the people that were responsible and make them pay for it. They drove to the house, they armed themselves with weapons. The defendant acknowledged that they showed him how to use a gun. He then went up to the door. He did wait until he held the door open with his leg. He waited until he saw the door start to open, and then he fired a number of shots directly into the center of a door right where a person would be. It wasn't like he fired the gun up into the air or someplace where you could say that maybe he was just trying to scare somebody. He fired right into the spot where somebody answering the door would be. His own words, I think, very clearly showed premeditation. And then on top of that, you have testimony from other witnesses, including people who said that they did see him facing the door as he shot, which kind of refutes his theory that he was running backwards towards the car. In all, when you look at defendant's own statements, the statements from the other, from the testimony from the other gentleman who was in the car, and then the independent witnesses who had no connection to this killing, that was strong evidence of premeditation. And I think most telling is the district court's comments, both at the, I think it was at sentencing and also at the Van Cleave hearing. The judge who had sat through the trial and heard all the evidence said that if this didn't establish premeditation, he couldn't envision a scenario that did. Clearly, the district court was in a better position than you or I to make that type of an assessment. And we would respectfully ask that this court not disturb the jury's verdict on that issue. If there are no further questions, the state would respectfully request that the defendant's conviction be affirmed.
Any more questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
Justice Lucas, if I could first of all start with the jurisdictional question. I also agree that this court does have jurisdiction. The sentencing was complete at the time it was pronounced from the bench, and no other orders followed, so the appeal was timely. Your Honors, counsel asks you reminds you that this court does not reweigh the evidence. But once again, I would urge you not simply, I'm not asking you to reweigh the evidence. I'm asking you to look at the totality of the circumstances, and that includes the totality of the evidence that was presented. There was, I believe, if memory serves me correctly, a motion for a new trial, which raised the issue of the denial of the suppression at the end of the trial. And so this issue was preserved, that there was evidence presented that suggests that during the interview or the interrogation of Eli, he was incapable of making an informed, intelligent, and voluntary decision.
Help me by identifying the facts that you think are different. If you look at the totality of the circumstances, then what was at the motion hearing?
Okay. Well, the evidence, the main thing that comes to mind right now is the testimony regarding the amount of alcohol that was consumed. And also the evidence of lack of sleep. Obviously at the suppression hearing, there was a statement about I had three or four beers 12 hours ago. At the trial, there was additional testimony that suggested at least that there was cocaine at the party. There may not have been evidence that he consumed cocaine, but there was a large amount of evidence of the large amounts of alcohol that he consumed and the fact that he's not normally known for holding his liquor. So that all goes to where he was while sitting in the interview room at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, either still drunk or very hungover, if that answers the question somewhat. Counsel wants the court to focus on the voluntariness of the statement, and I, while that is an important aspect, it is equally important to focus on the intelligent and knowing waiver. And so, while all outside appearances seem that he was tracking the conversation and may be in favor of the state's position that this was a voluntary waiver, the other evidence suggests that he may not have been in a position to intelligently and knowingly waive his right to remain free from self-incrimination. And we always seem to push those two aspects aside and focus on the voluntariness, but the intelligence and making a logical, informed decision, and whether or not he was capable of doing that with given the lack of sleep and the amount of alcohol he had consumed, is equally important. If I could focus 1 minute on the issue of the 1507. Defense counsel suggests that she had discussed the defense of intoxication with the defendant. This was a planned idea that we are going to raise this issue of intoxication as the defense for your case. And yet she still did not talk with an expert to figure out What effect does that degree of intoxication have on your ability to make logical decisions? And I would suggest that the failure to investigate that key issue to her defense shows ineffective assistance of counsel, especially in conjunction with the other issues raised.
And what would that expert testify about or to?
The expert would testify to the exact effect on the decision-making ability that alcohol intoxication and maybe cocaine intoxication has on one's ability to make rational decisions. So rather than just leaving it up to jurors, some of whom may never have drank, some of whom may have had one or two drinks but never been intoxicated, to decide how intoxication affects the rational decision-making process, which certainly...
And that testimony about how it can affect people in the abstract would trump a video that shows a person that's operating with lucidity and comprehension of the questions. And I mean, I don't understand why that opinion about what could happen would have been the thing that would have overcome the other aspects.
The video simply shows what appears to be somebody who is tracking and answering questions appropriately. It does not reveal what is actually going on inside the defendant's mind. And there is a biological link, a neurological connection that can be made between how decisions are made and whether or not alcohol can degrade that ability, and not just in the abstract, but in through human biology and neurological science to show that this does degrade an ability to make logical, informed, intelligent decisions. And so simply the video of showing somebody standing there, much could be said about, I'm standing here, I don't appear to be unable to make logical decisions, but that doesn't mean anything about my intelligence or my ability to make logical decisions simply from viewing me and watching me as I sit in an interview room. We need to look at what is the neurological effect of alcohol intoxication.
We have any further questions? Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you both for your arguments this morning and also this afternoon. The court will take this matter under advisement.